day that the Lord has made. So let us rejoice and be glad. I am Pastor Sadie Thompson, co-pastor of He Is Risen World Outreach Ministries, located in the beautiful city of Church Point, Louisiana. Our address is 122 South Main Street in the beautiful city of Church Point, Louisiana. I just want to thank my listening audience today because you could have been anywhere else doing anything else, but you decided to grab your coffee, your juice, your toast, hallelujah, or even your water, and especially your B-I-B-L-E, and decide to spend 56 minutes with me. And I just want to thank you for that so much. Listen, I hope that everybody had a good weekend, that all was well. And even if it didn't go well, you made it today. So guess what? The devil is upset about it, but he might as well be glad because you're not leaving here before God says you are. Amen? Amen. So what we're going to do, we're going to talk about the Lord is our shepherd. The Lord is our shepherd. The Lord is our God. We're going to go to the 23rd Psalms. Let's see what the B-I-B-L-E says about it. Okay, let's go there this morning. I'm going to read from two different translations, the King James Version and the Amplified, which will make it so much clearer and to the point where even we're going to put the cookies down on the table where the kids can get it. You should be able to understand this. And it says, the 23rd Psalm says, "The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy," that's two angels, y'all, two of them right there, "shall follow me all the days of my life, and I," put your name there, "will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." This right here, I know you probably learned it as a child. If you ever went to Sunday school or vacation Bible school or just in church services itself, they will teach you the 23rd Psalms or the Psalms of David. And it is so interesting that David was the one who wrote the Psalms because David was the one who experienced God as a shepherd. David was a ruddy young man when he was sent out to tend the sheep. David come from a family of Jesse, and he had those 11 brothers, what not have you, and David was the ruddy one, so evidently must have been the baby of the bunch, and he just got on his brother's nerves. And so what they did was they sent him out to take care of the sheep. He's gonna be a herdsman. Now he was a young guy and he was ruddy, which means he was small. But David found out during that period of time when he tended the sheep that it was the Lord who protected him. That's why David could say, "The Lord is my shepherd. He hovered over me. He guided me. He protected me." Now, can you imagine being a sheep herder or a leader or a provider over sheep? Not just sheep, but you as a parent, you as a brother, sister, uncle, wife, you who has authority or a covering over an individual, you who have come in covenant, blood covenant with someone as a unit, as a marriage. Can you begin to imagine the things that you have to do to make sure that that individual that you are providing care for is being fed, is being clothed, is being protected from the protected from the weather, protected where they have food and clothes and electricity, protection. David found out that God himself was his protector. Because while he was out there, sheep being prey for wolves or what other wild animals could be out there, lions and bears, I don't know, but this I do know. While he was out there, there was a bear that came to took one of the little ewes from his sheep. David said, oh no, I have to protect this. This is my responsibility. This is my job. And he took it and he slew it. He killed it. Then he had another opportunity. He had another God encounter with a lion and he grabbed him by his beard. This was a ruddy young man who should have been in his father's house, but it didn't happen. David had that hands-on God's encounter that God is my shepherd. And guess what? There's comfort in that because you have that same opportunity. When you receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, he is your shepherd, your guide, your comforter, your leader. He is the author and the finisher of your faith, not somebody else's faith, but your faith. Right now, faith that's going to take you from where you are now to glory. Hallelujah. That's the shepherd. See, the path has already been laid out. It's already been set. All you got to do is line up with the word. You ain't got to figure it out. You just got to come into obedience. Let this mind that's in Christ Jesus put on the mind of Christ. See, this thing, salvation, righteousness, holiness, living it the way God wants you to live it, it's not hard. It's a simple decision. Choosing this day whom you will serve. Who you gonna serve? Stinking thinking? Who you gonna serve? What grandma said 50 years ago and everything she taught you, it wasn't living holy. Grandma and mama taught you a lot of things, but not all of it was dealing with holiness. Come on, somebody. See, what I love about the gospel, it makes you accountable for your action. You're not going to be saying, oh, Lord, I didn't know that. They didn't teach me that in my church. Oh, I didn't know that I had to be holy. I didn't know that I couldn't do that. No, no. Work out your salvation. The scripture says, work out your salvation. This salvation that we're talking about, this relationship that we're talking about with Christ, it is on you. It is a total responsibility thing. You can sit in a church all day long and that don't make you a Christian, somebody. But until you, that relationship is anchored, is secured, is a unit. I have 5 fingers, which makes a hand. I can make a fist, I can wave, I can stop. But it's only one hand, 5 fingers, which makes a unit. Different members, one body, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, unity, oneness with God, being your shepherd, to guide, to lead. This is a comforting thought. I don't know about nobody else ever needing to be comforted. But rest assured, knowing that God has got you, he's written your name in the palm of his hand. He's got your name written there. You and you and you. He's got you. When he made the world, he had you in mind. Oh my God. You are an afterthought in your Father's gene pool. It was a divine intervention that's saying, this child's going to be born this day. I'm going to bring this gift into the world for that, because we fit jointly together in the plan of God. God wanted a family. That's why he made man. at yourself and say, I'm glad to be in the family, y'all. I'm glad about it. I'm glad to be saved. I'm glad to come in covenant relationship with God, the Creator. It doesn't get any better than that. It doesn't get any better than that. Because one of the reasons why it doesn't get any better than that is your perception of where you are. See, a lot of times you see yourself as less than. And you know why? Because of past deeds, bad decisions on our parts from the past. Sometimes we bring it this foolishness into the present. But don't let your past get mixed up with your present, because you won't have a future if you keep living in the past. Shake it off. Repent. Turn away from. Repent not just means to turn away from. Or you can walk away from an argument, but you're still arguing in your mind and in your heart. But to repent is a change of heart. When the change of the heart as transplant has happened, there's going to be actions behind it. There's going to be a sign. There's a song that says, I know I've been changed. I know I've been changed. I don't act the way I used to. I don't talk the way I used to. I don't carry myself the way I used to. I know I've been changed. Well, since you know you've been changed, but does God know you've been changed? Has he written your name in the book of life? Has he written on the tables of your heart? That's the real change. Listen, 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 listen. I don't want to get away from myself. I'm got fired up here. Because I'm serious about your salvation. I'm serious about your walk with God. Because some of us be with our head down. How you going to see where you're going with your head down? I've never figured that out. I would fall. I got to look up. Look up into the hills which cometh your help. And your help cometh from the Lord. Come on, so see, you ain't got to do you ain't got to do this thing by yourself. You wasn't designed to live this in this world by yourself. You said that woman must be on some kind of drug. She just clapping and happy. Yes, I am, because it's the joy of the Lord that gives me strength, that provides that information to me. See, I'm not walking in this road by myself. I'm walking in the light. He's the way, the truth, and the light. And when the light comes on, the darkness is dispelled. Once your understanding has been embroidered, then you can embrace the reality that Jesus Christ is Lord, that Jesus Christ is real, and Jesus Christ loves you, but he's going to change you out of your mess and turn your mess into righteousness. You understand now what I'm saying? Then you can live an overcoming life in Christ. In him you live, in him you move, and in him you have your being, your state of mind. Let this mind be in you as in Christ Jesus. You in relationship with the Creator of all things. Now listen, listen, listen. See, David found this out because I'm excited, but I'm kind of getting away, but I'm not getting away because it's still talking about the goodness of God and what he want to do for you. Now look, this is what tickles me. David says, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures. Why he make you to lay down? Because you ain't got enough sense to lay down. You want to worry all night long. You want to worry thinking that your worry going to change the situation. Oh, you're going to pace the floor. God said, let out and sleep and rest, because he got that. See, worry and fear and doubt cancels out faith. It's just the opposite. Actually, fear and faith is just inside out. The energy that you take to fear, oh, I don't know. I don't know how that's going to happen. Oh, God, I don't know. I don't know how this is going to happen. I'm going to pay my bills. Oh, God, I don't know. I don't know. Stop it. You do know that God is going to make a way for you. Murphy's Law. Anything bad that can happen, it'll happen. Stop it. Stop speaking damnation over your life. Speak life over your life. I don't understand this situation, but I know the will of God for my life, that Jesus loves me. He's going to give me a way of escape, and the way of escape is in him. God, I need understanding about this situation. Begin to decree and curse. Take authority over that situation. Because see, David says, I'll walk through the valley of shadow of death. Stop right there, Pastor Sage. Stop right there. The shadow of death, you got to kill some fear. You got to die. Not no natural death. Don't turn the TV off because you said, I said I was going to die. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying you got to kill your fear with faith. See, the valley experience or the death experience is all that old mindset that you had before you got saved. It is the area where you go from death, from spiritual death, into a spiritual new life or the born again creation. This is the process where you learn to shed off and to put on a garment of praise. You drop that dreary and weariness of moaning and groaning and crying because you have now been resurrected into the newness of life. Just like there's winter and now we're into spring, y'all, and the blooms are beginning to blossom on the trees. The birds are chirping. You wake up in the morning, now we're in daylight saving time. When before you hit the feet, the birds are chirping, y'all. I can hear them just chattering in the morning time. The squirrels is moving around. Everything is coming to life. When you get out of the valley, you will experience the new life, but you can't have no new life without an old death. You must die to old perceptions on your mind, thinking that this is the way that it's supposed to be. The reason why you haven't experienced the newness of life, because you have not come into the covenant of Jesus Christ. The covenant. Agreeing that he's the Lord, agreeing that he loves you, agreeing that he has a plan for your life, agreeing that there's a better way of life, agreeing that you're more than a conqueror. To be more than a conqueror means you've already won the battle. The battle has been fixed. The battle is fixed because the king is here. The champ is here. Greater is he that's in you that is in the world. The great one is living in you, inside of you. The unity. He says, I pray that we become one. One with the Father and one with the Son. That they will become one with us. Oh God, that's my prayer. St. John 17 chapter, start at verse 20 through 21, 22. Okay, let me go there. Let me just go there. We're going to shut this down right now. Because see, that oneness, that's how you know that he is Lord. He is the good shepherd. That's how you're going to know. That relationship, that fellowship, that love. Oh, love. What love got to do with it? Everything. 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 God is love. Oh, yes, he is. Oh, yes, he is. And he loves you. Yes, he does. St. John, 17th chapter, 20th verse. This says, all the Bible scholars out there, you already know it, but for those who don't, it's written in red letters, and it'll be read in your Bible too. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. Oh my God, thy word, thy word, thy word. God has taken the foolish things such as preaching to bring salvation to man. Preaching the word of God. break any doubt any further. John 1:1. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Thy Word. The Word.
Okay. Okay.
That they, that he's talking about you, all, talking about us, man, may be one. Hallelujah. Not two, not five, not 25. But God says, according to his word, he wants you to be one. Uno. One. As the Father are in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us. Oneness. Unity. One. That the world may believe that thou hast sent me. Oh, yes. See, that's how you got saved. Because you believed. That's the only way you can come into a covenant relationship with God, is that you believe. There is no other way that man can be saved except in the name and the belief of Jesus Christ. You can forget it. You're not going to look at no rock. It ain't in the sun. It ain't in the stars. But it's in relationship with the King of Kings and the star of the stars, with this Jesus Christ.
Look. Verse 22.
And the glory which thou hast given me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. Oh my God, that's good news. That is good news. Oneness. Oneness with the King. Okay, we're in the valley. We're shedding off all the fear, all the doubt, all the unbelief. All that died in the valley. Now we're transforming. Get that little head out of the way. We're transforming, you got it. Now we're transforming from the valley, and we're now ready to transform or resurrect into the newness of life. The newness of life, y'all. See, now we got our mind, we lost the weight in the valley. We replaced fear with faith in the valley. You're ready to look forward to something to get up for in the morning. You ain't, oh, Lord, it's Monday, Lord. You know I hate Monday. I got a shirt. You know, they got T-shirts that say, die, Monday, die. No, die to stupid thinking. Die to stupid thinking and arise to life. Be resurrected with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The oneness with God, the Creator himself. Come on, somebody. Ooh, I is happy, y'all. Why? Because we have arised. We have arised to the newness of life. And now look. Yea, though I walk through the valley, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff have comforted me. The shepherd has prepared everything that you need that pertains to life and godliness through his word. This is my comfort in my affliction. Thy word has comforted me. The comforter is in the house, y'all. The comforter is in the house. The comforter wants to wrap his loving arms around you and heal you everywhere that you hurt. Because now that you're going to say, these are the words that you're going to speak with your lips, with God's words, you're going to say, greater is he that's in me, that's in the world. You're going to begin to say, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. No good thing will he keep from his servant. Why? Because he prepares a table before me. Oh, a table. You thought Thanksgiving was a feast. Thanksgiving has kind of taken away from it, but traditionally, it was a feast. Food for days. Just all the things you like was there, plus some more. That was a feast. Thanking for the harvest, thanking for the hard winter. But this table he's talking about is more than that. Let me tell you, there's a feast going on, y'all. We got some love at the table. We got some joy at the table. We got some happiness at the table. We got loved ones at the table. You got peace at the table. You got wholeness at the table. There's a feast going on at the table, y'all. Eat, drink, and be merry. You don't have no hangover on this new wine, because it's joy. Joy in knowing that you can do it. You can live this life. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. And you know what is so exciting about it? It's for you. And then he says, my cup running over. See, you're not going to eat, you see, from a Thanksgiving meal or a big Christmas meal, you eat one time. What about the other 364 days or 363 days in the year? You go hungry? Mm-mm. Not at this table. This table is a continual thing because he's always with you. No good thing will he behold from you. That's why you're not wanting. Your perception, your vision has changed. There's a set time and appointed time, but the vision shall not lie. Your thoughts are being elevated to come up to the standard of righteousness, right standing with God. Your praise is thanksgiving. Your praise has been turned into worship because now that coveted relationship with God is what you're desiring, what you're after. You are now a God chaser, pursuing the excellency of God, perfecting your praise. Because in the valley, when you were ready to give up, in the valley, when it looked like you couldn't go no further, in the valley, you threw up your arms and said, not my will, but thy will be done. I tried everything, God, and nothing worked. So I need you, God, to come in and fix me in the valley. That's what you learn. But when you come out of the valley where the feast is going on, this is what you learn. Lord, created me a clean heart, renewing me a right spirit, one that wants to serve you, one that comes in agreement with you, because I found out I need you. I need you more than air. I need you more than water. I need you. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than not to be entered in at all. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, which means it gives me direction, which gives me guidance. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I may not sin against you. Thy word is teaching me what you like, what you don't like. I will bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Oh, come and magnify the Lord with me. It is good that we come and magnify the Lord because he is good. God is good. God is worthy of all our praises. If we had 10,000 hands, we couldn't clap enough. 10,000 voices would not be enough. The one thing that God desires is to have that relationship with you, the oneness with you. And you're going to learn something about God. He loves you in spite of yourself, just as you are. But he cleans you up to make you just as he planned in the beginning. The joy of the Lord is your strength. The joy of the Lord is where the rubber meets the road. Because you're going to learn something about God during them valley experiences. You're going to learn if you can trust God. people say, and I have a problem with it. God is a right, right? He's late, but he never, he's an on time God. He's late, but he's on time. How can you be late and on time at the same time? No, there is a time and there's an appointed time. Everything that you receive from God is by faith. Everything that you receive from God, it is by faith. There's an old song that says, we come this far by faith. 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 You don't need a lot. You just need to use what you got. Faith. Faith. Without faith, you can't please God. You got to believe that he is God. Without faith, you couldn't receive the salvation, the promise, the newness of life. Without faith, everything is received by faith. So we have to work on our faith. We got to make our faith a priority. And if for some reason you have a doubt or you feel like God let you down and you can't trust him, he already know, but you need to open your mouth and tell him, Lord, I'm sorry, but I'm having an issue with my faith. Lord, I feel like my faith is weak. I feel like this didn't happen the way that I thought it should, or I don't know why you took my mama, or why did you allow that to happen to me, or whatever the issue may be, you need to confess that to be cleansed from all unrighteousness and to be moving forward to the promised land. See, your faith is a grain as a mustard seed, which is very tiny, but when it is activated with fertilizer of love and understanding and knowledge, it begins to grow. And the scripture says it's the strongest of all the herbs and the trees, and the birds lodge under it. Faith. Oh, faith. Faith is your friend, y'all. It's going to do everything that you need and more. And more. It's your access card. Your faith is the black card. It's unlimited. For those whose credit is excellent and they don't even have a credit limit, you got a black card. Yeah, just put that card down and get what you want. Hallelujah. I want to have a faith card. I want God, when he sees my name, sees my faith, that I'm granted access. You're granted access into the kingdom. You're granted access where you can talk to Jesus day by day, minute by minute. You have been granted access. But seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all of these things will be added unto you, the things that you need, because he prepared the table in the presence of your enemies. He maketh you to lie down in green pastures. For the pastures of the green must be lush. And so the things that you need is in the pasture. It's in the relationship. It's in the relationship. Everything that you need is in the relationship with God, which is communion, learning the word, spending time in the word, talking, prayer, communication, fellowship. Fellowship to me is more than one. You're showing up for church services, you're singing in the choir, or usher boarding, or whatever, your participation with the church, fellowship. But not only fellows in the ship with man, but fellows in the ship relationship with God. It's relationships issues. Moving from the past into the present. Moving forward and remaining calm. Getting off all the weight of doubt, fear, anger, resentment, anything that would block your progress. Because your faith will grow. It grows through some trying situations. That's the fertilizer for your faith. Because you found out that God, he is your provider. You found out that God, after you waited, after you suffered, after you went through the death experience, you found out that it was than maintain your mind. You should have lost your mind in that situation. You find out after your husband left you for another woman. You find out when your child was rebellious. You found out that God loves you, and you ran away, been gone for 2 or 3 years, never knew what happened to him, and never come in contact, and you've been laying, waiting, praying, and trusting God, covering that child, asking God to cover that child no matter where he is, that he be safe, or she be safe, and you just long to hear from that child. And one day, you get a phone call that says, "Hey, mother, I just want to let you know I'm all right. I'm sorry for everything that I've done. And I wanted to come home so many times, but I thought you'd tell me no because I acted out so bad." And you cry to that child and said, "I've been waiting here for you. What do you mean? Where are you? I'll send a ticket right now." That's what you found out about the love of God. See, you can never go so far that you're out of the reach that you can't come back home. You just gotta make your petition, make your request known to God. "I've been so far away from you. I haven't done everything right. I've made some horrible decisions. I've hurt a lot of people. I stepped up with people to get my way, to get what I needed. I was taught better, but I didn't do better. I know better, but I refuse not to do it. But I'm asking you to forgive me for all of my sins. Every last one of those that I know about, those that I don't know. I want a clean slate with you. I don't want to hide nothing else under the rug no more. I'm tired of playing church. Go to church, clap my hands on the pew, say hallelujah, shout and tell the people I love. And I went in empty and dry, and I left emptier and dry. I need my cup, not just to run over, but to be filled to the brim over and over and over. You said in your word, you were going to make me lie down by some green pastures in the still water. So the water means that it's running, but it's not so fast that when I go to take a drink that I have to, my face is buried in it, but it's just enough where I can just drink a continuous stream. And then I don't want to just drink. I need to be immersed in it. I need another dip. I need to be cleansed, so I need to take a bath in this water. I need to step into the rivers of life. I need to be cleansed from all unrighteousness. Because I made up in my mind, I found out during the trials and the tribulations in the valley that I need a Savior. I need to be resurrected from this old man of doom." And the word of God says that the word is quick, powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword. So the word of God cuts you in when you hear it, and it cuts again as it comes out, discerning the joints and the marrow inside the bones. But it separates the soul. So the soul is where your emotions and your decision-making lie. Right then and there, it's cutting it in and saying, "I need God." It's overriding your intellect that wants to do what it wants to do, when it wants to do, and how it wants to do it. Your intellect. But the soul man needs the Savior. The soul man wants more. And God not only is available to give you more, his desire is to bless you exceedingly, abundantly, more than you could ask, think, or imagine. He says, "Eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard the things
He's already prepared the way. He's already prepared the blessing. That sounds like a shepherd to me, y'all. The shepherd. The shepherd. Is he your shepherd today? Have you made him Lord over your life today? See, today is the only day that counts right now, because today is the day that we're having this conversation. We didn't have this conversation yesterday, but we're having it today. The day that you hear my voice and hearken to it, that's the day that salvation comes. Today. Right now. Right now that faith has come alive in your heart, in your mind, in your soul. Oh, if they had a heart to what? To serve me as their Lord. Or if they made a decision to make me Lord over their life, then the blessings will overtake them. He told you right here, he's telling you right here, surely and goodness shall follow me all the days of my life. How many days? All. How many is all? All. What part of all you don't understand? All encompasses all. It's for you today. Oh, all the blessings of God is yay and amen. So be it. It is done. So shall my word be that it shall prosper in the thing whereunto it is sent. It shall prosper. Let's go there to Isaiah 55. Go there right quick. We got about 10 minutes, I think. Something like that.
Yeah, you got about 12 minutes.
All right, we got enough time. We got enough time, y'all. We got enough time. We got nothing but time. I want to read it in the Amplified because it speaks loud, like me. I'm kind of loud sometimes. At least that's what they say, but I don't understand that. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth, it shall not return unto me void, without producing any effect or uselessness, but it shall accomplish that which I please and purpose, and it shall prosper into the thing for which it was sent. The word of God is going to be in you. Once you receive him, because he is the word. So when you speak the word aloud, mix it with faith, because the faith cometh by hearing the word of God. Once you speak that and it becomes alive and it's real to you, then guess what? That word is going to work. I'm going to say it slow. The word will work if you use it. So what are we going to do, Pastor Sadie? I'm glad you asked. We're going to work that word. We're going to work that word. And 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 that word is going to produce in our life. And we're going to be fruitful. We're going to be bearers of fruit. We're going to be some fruit-bearing trees. That's what God is pleased with. To see his attributes inside of you. You are the only living epistles that some people are going to read your life. People are watching your life, y'all. They're going to know if you're saved or not. You don't carry a big Bible and a big old pen that says Jesus, which means you saved. And you talk to your neighbors crazy, kick the dog when you come home, cussing and fussing, but you saved. The devil is a liar. See, you got to be saved at home. You're going to be saved at church. You're going to be saved on your job, if you're riding the bus, if you're driving your car. You should be the same and not fragmented. Unity, oneness with God. Hallelujah. And let me tell you something. You won't have to ask anybody, is God really real? Because if you're in covenant relationship, you'll know. You'll know that you know that you know. And the beautiful thing about that, you're not going to just keep it to
gonna share. You're gonna be a good listener. You're gonna be a peer. You're gonna be good. Because you remember that could have been you. Oh, but the grace of God that sheds abroad in our hearts. It's the grace of God, the love of God, the power of God to keep you from all hurt, harm, and danger. The power of God. We talked about that last week about the power. The power's in the word. You can live the power. You can do the power. The power of Christ to keep you. Yes, you can. Yes, you can learn to love people who are unlovely. Yes, you can. Yes, you can keep your mouth shut, say, yes, you can. Bite your lip. Yes, you can. You can do all that. You can do all things through Christ which strengthens you. Yes, you can. Because the plan that God has for your life is good and not evil. Plans to prosper you. See, he's already made the plan. You just got to read the blueprint. You see how it's so simple, y'all? He's already made the plan. You just got to read the manual of instructions. That's all. You must read the manual of instructions to understand the plan or the map to navigate your way through life. Don't do like some of us. We have manuals of instructions that we never read until the thing don't work. And then we go like, well, let me see what's wrong. And we find out, oh, with a brand new car. Don't, you know, like they say, oh, you got to break the car in. No, you ain't got to break the car in. Read what it said. Don't go over so many, 55 miles an hour for so many miles and all like that. But no, we believe we got jam it on out there to break it in. By myths and old wives tales. Read the manual of instructions to get the full benefits out of it. Don't you want your benefits? Oh, the money you get paid on a job is good. That's one of the first things you ask. But for me, what kind of benefits are we talking about? Do I got health insurance? Do I got dental insurance? Do I got to pay? How much is that? Is it half my salary, a third of my salary? What is that? But with God, he gives you all things that pertains to life and godliness because he is the good shepherd. And you shall not want. Good shepherd. He takes that rod, pull you in. Going too far to the left, pull you back in. Going too far, going out the yard, the word arrests you. It's the love of God that will make you put that drink down. You got a problem drinking, smoking, or whatever it is, your drug of choice is, fall in love with Jesus. Fall in love with Jesus, and you won't want to do those things no more. You won't want to do that anymore. Don't you know that your body is bought with the price, the blood of Jesus? You want to resurrect that body? Oh, I know you say, oh, I've heard this before over and over again. And guess what? Faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the words. So you're going to hear it over and over again. Do you get it? So we can move to the next thing. Don't you want the blessings to overtake you? He said goodness and mercy gonna follow you. So it ain't like you, you know, I don't know how to make it any plainer than this. Get your mind right. I guess that's what I need to just say. Get your mind right. Think on these things. Whatsoever is just, whatsoever is pure, whatsoever is lovely, if it has any good report, if it has any virtue, think. Let's go to the throne of grace right quick. And we just want to thank God for who he is and what he's doing in our life. Father God, as I come into the throne of grace, I want to pray for the brokenhearted today. I want to cover them in the blood. I want to pray for the fearful today, but I want to pray for everybody who wants to come in agreement with your word. It wants you to be their shepherd and they don't know how. I want to stand in proxy for that right now. Father, as we come into the throne of grace, we acknowledge you that you are Lord of Lords and Kings of Kings. We thank you, God, for your infinite mercy. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your love. Oh God, we lift you up today because you are the author and the finisher of our faith. I apply the blood to everybody under the sound of my voice, standing in their need, God. You said you're going to give them everything that pertains unto life and godliness. You are the good shepherd. Teach them, God, and love on them, God. Send them people to love on them, God. Let them know they are not forgotten. They are not the least. That you, God, paid the price, that they don't have to suffer anymore. God, I thank you because this is the day. You said the moment that we hear your voice, the moment that we believe, that's when faith was released. I release their faith right now, that it touch and that it be a sweet-smelling sacrifice unto you, that you, God, will be satisfied with the things that they've offered up unto you, that you, God, are the Lord of their life, and they say, yes, God, we surrender everything. We say yes to your will and yes to your way. Oh, God, I need you to touch and move by your power and stir it up. And they're in agreement that they want everything that's standing in their way that's not pleasing to you, that they throw it away. Take their sins, take their ailments, take their distrust, take their fear, and throw it into the sea of forgetfulness, and it'll never be risen again. We apply the blood to their life right now. We put joy and peace and godliness right there in the place. Resurrect them from the death and bring them into the newness of life. Let this mind be in them as in Christ Jesus. We just want to thank you. We just want to praise you because, God, there's none like you. I appreciate you again. The screen just went blank. Why is that? Thank you. We appreciate you so much, God. We just want to say we love you. We give you the glory. We give you the honor. I thank you, Lord, personally for my life. I thank you for my church, which is He Is Risen World Outreach. He Is Risen World Outreach Ministries, located in the beautiful city of Church Point. That's 122 South Main Street, where the bishop and the archangel of our house is Albert Ray Thompson, Jr. And come on out and visit us one Sunday at 11 o'clock. We would love to have you. And he is such an awesome man of God that just breaks the word down and makes it so simple. But he puts a twist to the obvious, which is how God just be magnified and glorified. We'd be so mindful to invite you, and we'd be just so mindful that you be covered this week and that you be enjoying yourself and that you come back and visit me next week at 11 o'clock. And Lord only knows what we're going to talk about then, but this is what I want you to remember today. The Lord is your shepherd, and you shall not want. God bless you. God keep you. That is my prayer. And remember this. I love you, and Jesus loves you, and ain't nothing you can do about it. And he is risen. I love me some you. This is your co-pastor, Sadie Thompson. I love you. God bless you so much.